Good evening. My name is Peter Breedveld. On my left is Lila Korman from America. She wrote a book, drew and wrote it, called Unterzachen, and it was translated in Dutch called Meideles, and which is Yiddish for girls. Unterzachen is Yiddish for...
under things.
Under things. Underwear, right?
No, under things.
Under things.
Yeah, it's a little bit broader than underwear.
On my right is Dominique Goblet. She's from Brussels, Belgium. She wrote a book together with Kai Pfeiffer, right?
Exact.
And it's called Als het klikt. And in English, I guess you would say when it...
Meer als het klikt.
If it connects, right?
Yes.
So that's a typical phrase.
Meer als het klikt.
Excuse me?
Meer als het klikt.
Meer als het klikt. Yes, that's... Excuse me. Let's just look at some drawings first and talk about the work first of Lila Korman. So what are we looking at? This is a page.
So I have actually no idea which images are coming, so this is all interesting to me. This is a page from an ongoing collaboration with my friend Diana Esposito, who her stage name is Luna of Cairo. She's an American who is a professional belly dancer in Cairo. And we did a story. The genesis of that story was a Facebook post in which the big dramatic turning point was, she said, she was trapped by a crowd. She couldn't get into her apartment building. And then she said, luckily, a fight broke out down the street. And I thought that line was so funny that I contacted her and I said, let's collaborate. Let me draw that story you just told. So we did this story for Symbolia magazine, which is an online comics magazine, about her experience living in Cairo. This is in the interim period between the revolution that deposed Mubarak and the other revolution that deposed Morsi. So this is right before Morsi fell, or was pushed out, however you want to say it. And she's talking here about some of the experiences she's had in the street with street harassment. But the piece is also just kind of about her life as a dancer in Cairo as well.
Okay. Could we go to the next image, please? This is from Unterzachen, right? From
Yeah, Redness. This is my favorite page, actually.
Why is it your favorite page?
Because I'm obsessed with Greek mythology. And I love the idea of these two sisters falling asleep talking about the myth of Persephone, which I didn't realize until I was an adult is a story of a rape and abduction and a woman being a girl held prisoner. I just never thought of that. It's so metaphorical and so abstract when you're a child reading that myth. So in this page, the sisters Fania and Esther are falling asleep and... Fania can read and Esther can't read yet. So Fania has to tell her stories from books that she reads. And so she's telling the story of Persephone.
Yeah.
And then something happens after that, the immediate scene after this, that makes it more relevant. But that, and I'm not going to say what it is, I think you know, but that was not intentional.
Okay.
I put it together and then I realized what I had done. I was like, that's good.
Really? Yeah, let me say something about what Unterzachen is about. It's about two girls 100 years ago in the Lower East Side of New York, the Jewish neighborhood there.
Jewish-Italian.
Jewish-Italian.
Jewish-Italian and Irish, traditionally, yeah.
Okay. And one of the sisters works in a brothel, and the other becomes a abortion...
Sort of midwife abortionist, yeah.
Yeah. So it's about, is this about women taking control of their own sexuality, would you say?
I would say that's part of it. I wanted both characters in the book to fight for their independence in their own way, not in a polemical way, but I wanted them to not, I wanted them both to stake out a position where they don't get married, but for very different reasons, you know, where they're bucking tradition. But the book really became kind of a hairy beast as I wrote it. It got longer and longer, and so there's a lot of things that ended up happening in the writing.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Does it make sense to you, audience? Can we go to the next image, please? Yes. What is this?
This is just a painting I did. Just a watercolor painting. In fact, Yeah, there's a personal significance to it that's hard to describe.
Okay.
I guess on an
intuitional level, we can all grasp what it's about, can't we?
I don't know. I feel like everyone would have a very different interpretation. Some might think this is about menstrual cramps.
Okay.
It's not.
not what I thought about.
What did you think about?
A person entangled in, I thought it was very telling.
Entangled in what?
Well, entangled in something. In a symbolic entanglement.
I was definitely in a symbolic entanglement when I painted this.
See? Can we go to the next?
Actually, it was a literal, almost literal entanglement as well.
Next, please. This is about the... this is a page from the... a story about Cairo, right?
This is another thing from... So I should stress that Luna is the person who wrote all of the text that you see in these pages. She sends me huge blocks of prose, and I break them up into text that's usable in comics. So I end up kind of restructuring what she writes, but it's her words.
Can we go to the next image, please? Another page.
And here she's describing the class system of belly dancers and dancers in general in Cairo. So it's a very, this is dance nerd stuff, by the way. So if you're interested in dancing, which maybe one or two of you are, this will be interesting to you. For the rest, I don't know. But there are rigid class distinctions for dancers in Egypt. So if you dance in one context, it's unlikely that you will ever move into another. You either do street weddings, or you do five-star hotels, or you are a folklore dancer, or you are a Zeffa dancer, and that's the dancer you see in the lower right.
Yeah. May I point out the really sensuous lines of your work?
I've always really enjoyed working with a brush.
This is the effect of your brush. Yeah. So it would have looked different if you used a, like a pen.
Yeah, I can't draw with a pen anymore. I feel like I'm cutting into the paper with a razor. I guess it's a very physical, drawing for me is a very physical act.
Yeah.
So the connection with the brush and the paper is more important to me.
Okay. Next image, please. This is from Yahrzeit, right?
Yeah.
Yahrzeit is about...
So Yahrzeit is a comic I did about trauma and PTSD. I don't know what you say in Dutch, post-traumatic stress disorder.
I think we... Post-traumatic.
Okay, the same. So I lost a child a couple of years ago, very suddenly, very unexpectedly. My first child died in her sleep. And after she died, I thought a lot about my grandparents who were Holocaust survivors and never talked about it. And I thought about the burden that they carried around. And I wasn't thinking, I was just missing them, and I wanted to hold my grandfather's hand again. So I had... That's not the page that's here, but there is a drawing of us holding hands. We only held hands in real life when I was very little and when he was dying. But I remember the feeling of his hand, and I just wanted to draw it again.
So, I'm not sure if I quite understood that story. Is it about somehow a strange paradoxical consolation you got from the suffering from your grandparents?
Maybe consolation is, I don't know if that's the right word, but I don't know if there's a better word. Solidarity.
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 Right.
Well, I think that trauma is something that you think you will not experience. If you didn't experience it at a young age and you go into adulthood safe from it and you think, okay, phew. But I think that eventually everyone will be traumatized by something, and I think that it doesn't make you special, trauma. It makes you human. So I was thinking about that a lot, and I was also I just wanted to put his experience and mine together in some way, symbolically.
Yeah. You're very open about it. Also, you published this story on the internet.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I published it on Tablet magazine.
Didn't have any qualms about it?
No. Oh, no. I think, it's really important to talk about things like that, because people who have lost in that way, or many other kinds of pain, feel very isolated. So the more you talk about your own, the more you're helping other people. It doesn't mean you're obligated if you're not the kind of person who likes to talk.
Yeah, so it's to create more solidarity, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, for people who can't or won't, for whatever reason.
Next image, please. Another page from Untersuchen.
I really had fun doing this page.
Yeah? Why?
Well, so at this point, the book is in four sections, and in this section, Esther has become a lady of leisure, shall we say. She lives in a penthouse. And at this point, I took off into some fantasy inspired by old movies where, you know, American films from the 1930s where everyone's living in impossibly palatial apartments and wearing beautiful dresses all the time and have perfect hairdos. I know it's a fantasy. So here she and her sister have finally started speaking to each other again. And Esther convinces her sister to allow her to cut her hair in the style of the time.
Next image, please.
This was a printing I should have done a better job with printing this one. I was trying a slightly different composition with the circles, and it didn't quite end up the way I wanted it, but that's okay.
Okay. So what were you trying to do?
So many years ago, I went to Turkey, and I went to this place called Meryem Ana. How many of you have ever been there? No one. Okay. So this is... it's on a Christian pilgrimage route because they claim that, and I will quote, "This is the house where the Virgin Mary died. But it's not the actual house," they say. We had to build a different one. So, I mean, you know, I think that they put this... Well, I'll get to that in a second. It's a pilgrimage site. It's really beautiful there. It's in the mountains. It's gorgeous. And it's really close to this beautiful Seljuk mosque that was also a wonderful place to visit. So there's a lot of sacred sites. There's also the Artemision and all. It's been a place of pilgrimage, really, for thousands of years. So I started to get interested in those layers of history. And when we were at Meryem Ana, my friend and I saw that there was this keyhole-shaped pool that was much older than everything else at the site, kind of off to the side, and no one was paying attention to it, and it didn't have a sign. And we felt like, this is like a goddess temple that they just slapped this Christian chapel on top of, probably. That's our theory. We don't know for sure, but we really felt like, I felt like this is a place people have been coming to invoke whatever they believe in for a very, very long time. So I was thinking about that spot. And again, it's you know, there's a lot of fantasy in it, mostly fantasy. I'm just imagining different people, women in pain at different time periods in the same spot.
Next image, please.
Yoo-hoo.
Oh, now we're...
I had nothing to do with that.
No. It's a nice logo there. So next image, please.
Beautiful fonts.
Now we're going to talk about the work of Dominique for a while. Yes. Would you like to explain? Why is there a wolf's head? And so does the wolf's head belong on the...
As
human
Lila
body?
Said, it's in an interpretation.
Okay.
Do what you want.
Okay.
No, I joke. this is coming from a book I made called Wolves Men.
Yeah, that wasn't translated in Dutch, was it?
Yes, because
it was.
We don't need a translation because there is almost no text except on the beginning, which is translated in English. So it's a book I built on... it was my first experience to find solution between what I make for exhibition and what I make for books. Because when I make comics, I always try to go out of the field of comics and find some kind of inspiration by other fields, could be music or movie or art plastique, beaux-arts, comme on dit, Kunsten.
Yeah, sculpture, yeah.
No, not sculpture, more contemporary art or things like that.
Yeah.
Painting. And I was during a long time very troubled by the fact that comics were not really well considered. And contemporary art has...
comics weren't taken seriously, voilà. As seriously as art.
And it was a problem to me because I was embarrassed by this because I didn't understand that. And also I was really wondering how to put bridge between my two fields. And I started this book, which was a project more. I started this project by an image you can see all the time in newspaper, which and television and so on, which is two men dressed in suit, shaking hands, and it's kind of, now it's a pact, we are in peace forever, you are my friend, I shake your hand, and no war anymore, it's finished, really, it's peace forever. And naturally, when you are looking at these kind of pictures, you never believe it. And I think it's an interesting image because it shows something, but make you thinking about something else. It contains a lot under. So I started to take this image and reproduce it a lot of time. Maybe 200 or 300 times. Some very big, some small, but all the time two men shaking hands like that. And when you repeat an image like that a lot of time, all your unconsciousness come out because you don't think anymore about the subject with fear. How will I make this hand? How they are represent? After a while, you know how it is. And then you draw more freely and something else come out. And after a while, another subject came out, which was this suddenly this wolf head. And I started to repeat this. One or the other one, man has a wolf head. And each subject like that give... born to another subject. It was a burning house, shipping, sheep crying, dark forest, lost children, and so on. And they are all connected by these first images, which in fact spoke about threat. And I realized that when I had all these images by family, I could start to compose it like a music composition. Three sheep crying, two men shaking hands, one dark forest, two sheep crying. And I built it really like, you know, the Bach, les variations de Bach, variation of Bach.
Okay, yeah, like a
playing by Glenn Gould, notamment. Voilà. There is a sentence which is time to time repeated, but with another kind of, and it's a little bit like a nightmare. You enter in a room, suddenly you are in another one, and I played with rhythm, silence, intensity, and so on.
Yeah.
So to me, it's still narration. When I put it on the wall, I create a lecture on the wall. And when people want to buy it, I ask them to buy not one drawing, but two or minimum three. And being the last chain of narration, they decide the story, how to read, they will be the last chain.
Okay, a very unconventional approach.
Voilà.
To comics.
And with the book, I proposed a sequence that I propose that you can read as a kind of, like you hear music with tension and so on. But you can read this book by the end, or you can open just two pages. You are not obliged to read all the story like a linear story. So this is...
You can start at any point.
Voilà. This is the the way I try to re-approach comics is...
Okay, we're going to look at some more images first, okay?
The same. So then you can same thematic.
Next, please.
I think it's in the same book.
It's all from the same book, right?
Yeah, I hope I didn't give... Ouais, voilà, ça c'est le livre in question. Voilà, this is another book. Maybe we can stop here.
So, okay, would you stop, please? And yeah, these are some, you know, like medieval images.
And this is an image from a preview book, because each book I really try to start as as something new, totally new. I don't keep the same style. I don't want to. And even in the book, I don't understand how artists can keep the same character, the same style for all his life, like series 13. You know, some series which are never finished, and the artist is obliged to take this for all his life. So boring to me. So here it's a kind of autobiography. It was my most, biggest comics, which is a real comic with bubbles, with panels and so on.
Okay. You mean text balloons?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Voilà.
You don't say bubbles here? We say word bubbles, too.
No? Yeah. We say bubbles?
Really?
Yeah. Ah, okay, super.
But you don't call it balloons? I thought it was balloons.
Balloon, bubble, you know.
We say balloon.
It's interchangeable.
Oh, voilà. I try to explore here something difficult in my life, which was my childhoodness, which was really violent. And because my mother was someone really particular for me, because she was really, really violent, physically and morally. And my father was kind of alcoholic. And I knew when I was in the school that if I can make something from my life in comics, it will be at distance. It took 10 years to me to make this book because till the end, I was wondering how to find a good way to tell something like that so close. I didn't want to make a kind of, very emotional, tears, full of tears book. And I didn't want to take too much distance. And at least the solution I found was that in autobiography, especially in comics, I think you don't have to speak about the reality, but more the trueness, our trueness.
Yeah.
So you in comics, you naturally you will use the reality, but you will choose some moment that you will put together like a patchwork, which doesn't exist together, but by that movement, you can find your trueness. And in my case, my trueness was that I must make you feel that, I must make you understand that my mother made something monstrous, but I wanted you have empathy for her. And if I can succeed this, my challenge is okay.
Is
that was
you,
my challenge.
Is that why you choose comics as a medium?
Yes, exactly.
Is that the best way to tell your story? You couldn't have done the same and, for instance, prose?
Or? Yes, because you can say something with the text and something else with the image. For instance, you can say the little girl sleep on the text, and during you read the little girl is sleeping which is in fact what the parents believe. On the image, you see her running on the roof of the house. So this is really an interesting specificity of comics,
which I use. Is it the same for you? Is it, was comics as a medium, was that a really a very conscious choice that you made?
I started out in art school, actually, studying painting and printmaking and some other things, and I got really disenchanted with the whole idea of the art world. I just felt like there's no future for me there. It's dead. It's not dead for everyone. Just for me, this is not a viable option. Like I wasn't too interested in what the themes were that people were exploring at the time when I was in school and what was going on. I really wanted to draw a lot, just a really direct experience with drawing. And then I started to, I always loved comics. Actually, I always wanted to draw them, and I thought that it was too hard, that I wasn't capable of it. When I started drawing comics, I realized this is really for me, because here I can publish something and make 100 copies of it, and someone can buy it for $2 and stick it in their back pocket, and I can have, hundreds of people can have it for very little money, and that to me felt much more democratic. I liked that.
Okay.
Sort of an outgrowth of the punk scene and fanzines and.
I see.
Yeah, so,
so it
was
happened
part
kind of
that.
Of organically, it was not. It's not that you felt that comics were the best.
Oh, I did. I had a whole manifesto. If you talked to me when I was 25, I would have given you an earful about it, but I wouldn't do that now.
Okay. Could you go to the next image, please? Yes. This is from, I forget, this is from...
Souvenir d'une journée parfaite.
Okay.
Ah, non. It's the same book. as you can see, between the preview images and this one, the style is really different.
Yeah.
It's a book, as I said, I made in 10 years running.
You jump from style to style in one book.
Yes, and yeah. I wanted to keep the different style, also to express time past, because I don't want to hide this. And also because I want to express some part of the book, because this is the start of my modern life as an adult, where I wanted to speak about my love life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also a question of rhythm, because here I start to make this chapter with only two panels by page,
mm-hmm.
because it's happened in Wallonia, which is a very dead zone, like an old industrial, old dead city,
yeah.
which anything happened today. And I wanted to make the lecture very slow yeah. at that time.
Okay, next image, please.
Yeah, it's the same.
Okay, and the next. Well, this is from your last book. Wanneer het klikt.
Meer als het klikt.
Meer als het klikt. Excuse me. Yeah, this is a very strange book. You have to kind of, as a reader, construe the story from... the images that you and Kai Pfeiffer give us. It's not obvious what it's about, is it?
We met in a festival and we immediately fell in love of the work of each other.
Mm.
And I proposed to him to start a kind of play. And he sent me 5 pages and proposed me to work on a thematic, which was love on internet website.
Mm.
And the
just makes this fall into place beautifully.
And the concept was working on a page divided in 4 panels. I don't know if it's the case. On could you
go on to the next image, please?
And next one.
And next.
No,
I don't think.
No,
we
you
have
can
a...
you can come back. Sorry.
Huh.
And wait, voilà, we will stay there. Normally,
yeah, because every page in the voilà. Rest of the pages in the
this
book,
is the cover.
They all have 4.
Voilà. Normally, in the book, you have only 4 panels in each pages, and voilà, exactement. This is the construction, and all the book is like that. And the idea was to try to inverse the I'm sorry for my English, a little bit hesitate. The process we used to make in comics is writing a story, then make a storyboard, and then starting with images. Here we tried to inverse the process and working on the thematic, which you know, and we send each other pages, so we react or not on the page we received from each other. And the idea was, when we will have 100 pages, we stop, we cut all pages in four, mixed all this material, a little bit like we do in a movie, and see if it's possible to create narration based on this bank of images.
Hmm. So that's how you worked. You made a few pages, you send it to Guy Pfeiffer, he made a few pages, he sent it to you.
But the reality was not totally what we expect, because we received this page and react. In fact, when we arrived at 100 pages, a Skeletus narration, Skeletus already exists with character, with some pattern like the lobsters and so on. And we only had to add 50 other pages just to, comment dire, boucher les trous avec du... Voilà. Can you say it louder? Voilà, fill the holes. Comme du ciment, comme cimenter l'histoire, en fait. Mais l'histoire existait, malgré nous. Oh, sorry, I speak in French.
Yeah, yes.
Despite us, the story came. It was a real magic.
Okay. So, well, time's going fast when we're having fun. So let's talk about, you know, the similarities and differences in both of your work. Because what struck me, but I could be wrong, so, you know, just tell me if I am. Both of your work, your latest books are about sexuality, female sexuality. In Untersachen, sexuality seems to be, you know, a heavy burden for everybody. You seem to have a lighter approach to sexuality, right?
Very hot.
Very hot?
Not at all.
No, so you have a humorous, you know, you seem to make fun. Well, you both seem to make fun of male sexuality, right?
Normally, personally, not at all, because it's the first time I approached this thematic, and I made it because my my partner, Crazy, really, provoked me with this. But I was totally in shock.
Do you mean Kai Pfeiffer or your
Kai Pfeiffer.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
But I was really surprised and said, hey, tu es vraiment crazy, hein? How is possible? Normally, I'm very, très, je suis un peu... Non, quand même pas, hein? Not personally, hein?
Calm.
Comment dire, un peu...
But the mid.
Non, to me, sexuality is really difficult to speak about in comics. How to find a way not stereotyped? Because this is my only question in general in art. How to speak about things without stereotype? And I think sex is the most difficult thing to me.
To communicate about.
Without stereotyped.
Without stereotype, of course, yeah. Mm-hmm. How about you?
It's funny, I mean, it creeps into my work whether I want it to or not. And there's a point at which this is going to sound really disingenuous, but I'm not in control of what happens in the story anymore.
Hmm.
I'm constructing the story as I'm doing it, and I do what is necessary for the story.
Okay, but am I wrong if I say that sex in Untersachen at least is also in the story about Cairo is a burden.
It is a burden in very different ways in both stories. Oh, maybe not so different. The expectations on women are heavy in these places and times. But it's funny because the reason why I keep saying it's funny is because for me, in my personal life is completely different from my comics. It's total fiction, Untersachen especially. Mm. Well, the Cairo story is nonfiction, but that's not my life. The Maedalus is a novel, literally, it's a novel. So For me personally, I'm like the most boring vanilla person. I've been married for, what year is it? Almost 13 years to a guy I've been with for 17 years. So, you know, I don't have any kind of like tumultuous personal life that I'm drawing from. But it's all around in the culture. And, you know, I live in this culture where it's somehow permissible to have action movies, like this fire hose of horrible action movies and television where the people shooting each other all the time and terrible violence as a game for people. But sexuality is somehow some kind of, ooh, it's a taboo. And it's how we all arrived here. So, you know, get over it. Take the guns off TV and put some sex on it would be better. But, yeah, that's communism in my country. but I think that by necessity, when you start telling stories about women's lives, you cannot avoid subjects of sex that is not consensual, or sex that is for money, or sex that is consensual in a situation where you're not supposed to be doing it. You know, sex that is scandalous in some way.
Yeah.
For some reason, it just it's a. Would you? I see you nodding.
Sorry.
I see you agreeing. Yeah.
Yeah. Exact.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, in Untersagen, sex also seems a way to control other people, or to at least to
desire to control.
In
life, it can be a way to control other people. In real life,
yeah. Of course, that's why it's so realistic. Because I realized, because it's situated in an immigrant neighborhood 100 years ago, and when I was reading it, I thought this could as well have been situated in, you know, for instance, immigrant neighborhood in Amsterdam. In 2015, because you know there are the same hypocrisy, the same struggle that women have to go through to, you know, take control over their own lives.
And probably an immigrant community in New York City now, you know, it's only the languages and faces that change.
Yeah,
human beings don't change. It's just the cultural trappings that change, our clothing and maybe our mores. But there are no new stories.
Hmm. Yeah, and in your work, sex seems to be a way to ridicule people.
Oh no! Not at all.
You seem to be making fun of people trying to get into contact with the other and with each other, and the main drive seems to be.
I would like not, but it's true that in this book. We can say something like that. But in fact, the story which came like that by magical is the story of a woman who had a drama in her life.
Yeah.
And because of that, she fell in a kind of obsession of finding men or searching men on website, in love website. And the book is her projection, her story, what she imagined. And she imagined to invite all these men together at the same time, the same place, her house, her garden. And the garden became a kind of Greek garden, like paradise. And she can control all that men and decide what she will do with all that men together or not. Maybe make them pass some kind of exam or comment dit ça, des épreuves.
A trial.
Voilà. So she start to make them a little bit work to clean the house, but it's very difficult because there are a big mess of book. And there are so many books that there is no place to order them. So they just bring books nowhere without knowing where to go because it's impossible to attempt the walls. And then she said, no, it's too complicated. Go out and we will start to make holes because I remember there is a dog somewhere, a dead dog somewhere in the garden. I don't like that. I'd like to find it again because, in fact, I'd like to build, if you don't mind, if I can ask you this small help for me to build a swimming pool for me.
But yeah, she's very manipulative.
Oh, just a little bit.
Yeah. yeah.
No, she's on control, as you said. Yeah. She uses sex and desire as a big way to control.
At the same time, she seems to go through a big trauma. Because voilà. your story is funny at first sight, but there's a very serious undercurrent there,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. the 50 last page that we didn't put at the last pages, but through the story, give keys, step by step, to understand why she is like that.
Yeah. I have to confess, we invited both of you because you are women working in comics.
Yoo-hoo!
Yeah. Sorry, lately there seems to be, kind of like a wave of women producing very good comics. Do you feel the same?
I feel like that critical mass was reached a long time ago.
Yeah.
But maybe that's in the U.S. I don't know. It's
well, until a few years ago, comics seemed to be mainly the field of men.
Maybe here. In the U.S., it's been in independent and sort of more, art or story-oriented comics as opposed to like the mainstream superhero stuff. Women have been a big part of it now for at least a decade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. No, but it's recent, no? Isn't it?
That was my impression.
I mean, I remember that being asked this a decade ago and saying, no, it really is, like, it's almost become a non-issue at this point.
Decade is not that long.
I guess it's not that long, but when you consider, I mean, when I was first doing it, at this point, maybe like 18 years ago, I started drawing comics. There were plenty of female cartoonists back then in the U.S., and we were all making mini comics like Gabrielle Gamboa, Jenny Zervakis, Megan Kelso, Renée French, who was like everybody's goddess. I'm sure you know her work, yeah.
Franchement, évidemment.
Oui. Phoebe Gleckner, Debbie Drexler. Debbie's not drawing comics, anymore.
Debbie Drexler, yeah.
Do you know her work?
Yeah.
You would love it.
Very
She's so
strong,
great.
Very
Carol
strong.
Tyler. Like, these women, they were in Raw. They were in Twisted Sisters. These were big anthologies. You might be familiar with Raw here, because that was...
Raw was a magazine that Art Spiegelman started.
Art Spiegelman and Françoise Mouly edited this beautiful magazine of avant-garde comics starting in maybe 1979, I think.
Somewhere
80.
Yeah.
And they're the people who launched the careers of Chris Ware and Kaz and Charles Burns, and they also printed a lot of European comics. So a lot of us saw that when we were young, and oh my God, it's like completely life-changing.
Raw is the magazine where Mouse started.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he started running, and actually that might have even started with Arcade.
Really?
I don't know now. It's been a while since
I think it started in Raw.
You're probably
Art
right.
Art Spiegelman's Holocaust comic. Mouse, that's what we're talking about.
Mouse, which is the ticket for people like me in America to be like, hey, I make comics like Mouse, even though it's nothing like Mouse. But then it makes other people go, oh yeah, okay, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's the same in Europe. But what's a little irritating, I think, is that now since Mouse has been how long ago? 25 years ago, maybe?
Something like that, yeah.
30, yeah. And since Mouse, with Mouse, people started to realize that, oh, comics are not just for kids. But now every other graphic novel that appears, a reviewer seems to find it necessary to remark that, oh, gee, comics are not just for kids. There are comics for adults, too.
That's a running joke. That's a running joke. In the States with cartoonists, we're always going up to each other and saying, zip, pow, comics aren't for kids anymore,
because
that's the headline all the time. And, it's infuriating.
Yeah.
Also, can I just point out my semantic? This is the hill I'm going to die on. It's not a graphic novel if it's a memoir or a work of journalism. Joe Sacco does not write graphic novels because they're nonfiction. Because I don't know about here, but in the press in the U.S. now, everything's a graphic novel, as if it's like saying all movies are the same. Like,
yeah.
Michael Bay and Werner Herzog, they just make movies. It's the same,
Yeah.
Sorry, that's my little bugaboo.
Yeah, graphic novel is a genre, like.
Well, like a novel. I mean, fiction. It's just fiction, It's comics is the medium. Yeah, novel is the genre.
Yeah. How about you? How do you feel about that?
about a novel or about women?
Yeah, but you. Well, I guess in Europe, well, not in the Netherlands, but in Belgium.
When I started, it was almost any woman, women. And I remember well because when I started, Angoulême made the first big exhibition, women exhibition. It was one woman from each European country. And that's where I met the German. Oh putain, j'ai oublié son nom. C'est incroyable ça.
Where you met the.
L'allemande. Bon, ça va me revenir après. Anke Fürstenberger. I don't know if you know her.
She's great.
She's really excellent.
Yeah. Yeah.
And at that time, with also Caroline Suri from the Dernier Cri, we realized that it was. I was in a group of 10 people, men. I was the only woman. And I was really happy when I met a girl with a strong work, not for children, not cute with curly head and so on. Hair, and we wanted to organize a women group, a group of women. And each time we were speaking about that to a man, even men very close to us, they started to be really angry at us. Really, huh? I remember a conversation with Cornelius, which is a big now publisher of avant-garde in Paris. And he was so angry at us. Are you débilos? You are what, a feminist or what? You want to make...
Yeah, you
want to
make something of it? What
no,
kind of question
he said,
is that?
Ah oui, c'est ça. Et on va faire de l'art pour les Africains et de l'art pour les homosexuels et de l'art pour les femmes. Ça crée des... Comment ils disent? Des ghettos.
Right, yeah,
you
yeah.
want
right,
to
right.
make a ghetto of feminists. And I must speak during 3 hours with him to make him understand that when there is only a men group, nobody thought that it's maybe bizarre, all these men
right.
together. Why? Why yeah. are you together? And why we couldn't be for a while some women together, just to see if we exchange differently. I thought it's interesting.
And I find that really interesting that you say that. It gives me another point of view, because what's happening and what's been happening in the US for maybe 15 or 20 years now is, if you're a female cartoonist, you still get put in this little box, in a little ghetto, and there's still, you know, gallery shows that are only female cartoonists and anthologies that are only women and the best women cartoonists. And we are tired of this segregation. For us, we feel like the more you can put us in a ghetto and shunt us aside, you don't have to listen to us. And you don't have to think about being on the same plane with us and all of us being equal instead of us being different, us and them. And then also... I don't know. I mean, there's a good argument to be made, though, for what you're talking about. Commercially, it messes with us to be pushed aside into that little box. I don't know about in Europe, but in the U.S. for sure, it changes your commercial viability. And it's just annoying. There's another aspect of it, too, and maybe it's different here. I'd love to hear your point of view. I find that as a female cartoonist in the U.S., now people expect that everything you do is about yourself. It's always autobiographical. If you're a woman,
and
you're...
If it's possible, sexuality.
Right, yes. Especially if it has any sexuality. So, yeah, I've had people ask me if my book was autobiographical, which is insane, because it takes place 100 years ago and is about totally different people. I would tell you if it was me. But I feel like there's this expectation that we are always memoirists. But I don't know if that's the case here.
Mm-hmm. But, it was only an opportunity just to see if it opened other door, in the imagination, in the collective discussion and so on.
What happens when there's not a man in the room?
Oui, exactement. What we could speak about freely, because we speak differently if there is a man or not. It's a reality. And when he started to speak about feminism, I have to say, yes, but we are concerned, still concerned by feminism. And I must struggle with him for 2 hours to say, but we are still concerning by the women problems in the world. So, but after that, okay, but now I don't need anymore, but it was an interesting question.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
We're running out of time.
Yoo-hoo!
Yeah.
When we have fun.
Well, yeah, thank you very much. I thought it was an interesting conversation. Anyone want to ask any question? No?
How about the Weltschmerz?
We didn't talk about that enough?
Yeah, we did talk about Weltschmerz. Well, we didn't mention the word Weltschmerz.
Yeah, we didn't really talk about the world, maybe just personal.
True.
What does it mean?
What?
No, but yeah. Seriously, I didn't understand. Weltschmerz?
Weltschmerz is... I used it.
Seems nice.
Is it like suffering of humanity?
Couldn't you have asked me that before? Now you're embarrassed.
Which festival is this?
I really can't give you a good definition of Weltschmerz. Okay. Just lose it like that. It's like you have the suffering of the whole world on your shoulders.
Ah, okay.
Oh, now you understand? Blaine?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I don't. The pain of existence, exactly. Yeah, it's like you have the suffering of the world on your shoulders, and so.
Well, yeah, all the time.
Yeah.
Don't we all?
I hope you weren't disappointed too much that you came here before the Weltschmerz and we didn't do any.
Do you have a question about Weltschmerz?
You are absolutely right. I apologize.
Perhaps the panel should have been called Sex Comics and Personal Suffering.
I like Weltschmerz.
I do too.
I like that word.
This is the best named panel I've ever been on.
I think so too. Thank you very much.
No, there is a question.
Oh.
I think that most sex scenes in prose are terrible writing. I think it's really hard to write a good sex scene. That's why there's an annual Bad Sex Writing Award, which is hilarious, by the way. But I'm sorry, that's my flippant answer. That's a really good question. I think maybe, because images go right to your gut, and you don't have to imagine it. But... boy, I think I'd probably have a different answer to that tomorrow after processing that question.
It's also a little bit because of what's happened in Paris, and what's the difference between speaking about difficult taboos like there in
I'm a descendant of the underground comics, and so to me, there's no questioning for me. Like, I'm going to put that stuff in my work. And it's so a part of the culture of the art form that I work in. It's almost too expected, actually, if you know American undergrounds and all of their descendants. Does that make any sense? I hope that makes sense. I'd like to hear... Well, I'm saying that makes it a very comfortable place for me, yeah.
I have a good way to answer you. The chance we have with the drawing is the fact that you can express almost everything with an image which is not direct on the subject. For instance, I could tell my relationship with my daughter, by portraits of her through landscapes. I could make only landscapes and say, this is my daughter.
Okay, but we now have really have to make room for the next act. But
really you can.
I just would like to say one thing. Thank you very much for how you listen to us and to my bad English, because I really felt at ease, which is not all the time the case.
So no, I think your English was very sexy, but I think you, you can buy their books in the main hall, and I think both Lila and Dominique are there to sign and make drawings. And you can probably speak to them too, right?
Oh yes, we'll speak if you talk to us.
Thank you so much for coming.